It's Absolute Radio, and tonight in session, the marvellous Suzanne Vega. Let's hear it for Suzanne.
Thank you.
How are you?
I'm good.
It's been a while since we last chatted. We chatted in the beautiful British summer on the Isle of Wight, and here you are in the autumn. I did some reading up on you this time, and this fascinated me. I don't usually ask a question straight from someone's website, but this fascinated me so much to learn that between the ages of 4 and 12, you loved and knew everything about the Beatles.
Yeah.
So my question is, what happened at the age of 12? Did you just hate them all of a sudden?
No, I didn't hate them. I started listening to other bands.
But you didn't listen to anything else, really, between those ages.
No, that's right. And suddenly, I guess at the age of 12, I realized there were other bands. I think my... listening to like The Loving Spoonful or some nonsense like that.
Yeah.
And so my horizons broadened a little bit.
So would I be right in thinking that your earliest memories of music would be Beatles records?
No, because my parents listened to a lot of different kinds of music. They listened to jazz. They listened to... I had babysitters that would bring Motown records into the house. We sang folk music at home, but that wasn't what I was really into. It was just music that was around.
Mm.
And then, of course, Bob Dylan, because everybody's parents were into Bob Dylan.
Yeah. When was the first time you thought about a song as something you could create rather than something you could just sing?
The day my father wrote a song for my brother. My stepfather played the guitar often after dinner, and he wrote a song for my brother Matthew.
What was it about?
It was sort of like a reworking of... Where Have You Been, My Blue-Eyed Son? It was a sort of a reworking of that. Mm. So I had my own couple of lines.
Which in that song?
In the song.
Can
in
you
the
remember
song,
them?
Yes. It was something like, who will you marry, my handsome young man? Who will you marry, my dear? I'll marry my sister. Her name is Suzanne. She has a butterfly fan. So I was 9 years old, and I was just absolutely enchanted with the idea that you could create this world, you know, where anything could happen in a song.
Have you ever written a song specifically to woo somebody?
that's a very personal question.
Yeah.
No, actually, most of the time, if I'm writing a song about someone that I'm sort of in love with, it's more a sort of stay away type song. often they don't even know about it.
Yeah.
Yeah.
The series of albums you're doing, we're up to volume 2, and they've both been great so far. It's revisiting and reworking old songs. I'm always interested to, I mean, obviously you sing these songs when you play live, but what's it like to go back and put them under the microscope? Is it a bit like reading old love letters or teenage poetry?
Ooh, I hope not.
For you, though, as a writer, I mean, they're things that have been around for a long time.
Well, the things that have made it onto the records, I think, are they're not quite like going back and reading love letters or teenage poetry. You know, the ones that made it onto the record, I had a pretty good feeling about from the beginning. Mm. But there was one song, Ironbound, when I revisited that song, it really did take me back to 1986 and everything I was experiencing at that time. And in a way.
was it a good thing to go back to 1986?
It was good not to be there. Again, I'm very happy to be where I am.
Singing about your hometown there, which... Yes. Have you ever fallen out of love with New York? Have you ever had
oh,
one
yeah.
of those phases?
Oh, it's a love-hate relationship.
When you hate it, what do you hate about it?
Oh, because it's dirty and there's a lot of suffering in the streets and, you know, homeless problem and... It's out of control sometimes, but then there are other things that I really just love about it.
Yeah, such as?
Oh, I love the museums, and I love the heights that you can achieve there. You know, the education and the culture there, and the fact that you can come from the most miserable street in the most miserable neighborhood, and through education and bettering yourself that you can create these beautiful, dazzling things like just like 50 blocks away from where you grew up. Yeah. That's amazing to me.
Suzanne, what are you reading at the moment?
I'm reading this book again that I really like called The Care of the Soul by Thomas More.
What sort of a book is that?
Well, it's I suppose it might be classified under theology or sort of self-help, but it's sort of a combination of psychology and it's a study of the soul. This man, Thomas More, has written a lot of books about the soul as distinctive from the spirit, for example, and just how you can sort of care for the soul in everyday life.
What's the one most important thing I could do? Because my soul is in very ill health at the moment.
Is it really?
Yeah.
Probably to slow down and pay attention to what it's telling you and pay attention to your...
No, I've got
to
shut it out.
Okay. Well, then you're just going to continue suffering. I'm sorry.
Have you? I mean, I know that some of your lyrics have been published before now, but have you ever thought about writing fiction?
Yeah, I think about writing fiction.
What stops
I'm on
you?
Tour too much to sit down and write any fiction or even write any memoirs. I mean, it's about all I can do to squeak out a blog now and again and Twitter once in a while. Twittering takes up, you know, a lot of brain space for 140 characters.
Well, you've got to self-edit. I've noticed that you keep getting yourself locked out of Facebook when I've looked on there. You seem to be struggling.
That was only for 1 week.
Do you struggle with technology generally?
I do, but I still embrace it, but I still struggle with it. Mm-hmm. I have anger management issues with my devices. I've broken a couple of hard drives by pounding on it with my fists. So I'm trying not to do that anymore. But I still embrace it when I'm not wrestling with it.
Do you go to your daughter for help?
Yeah, actually I do. I go to my daughter and my mother, who is actually a computer systems analyst and has been since the mid-70s. And she's great.
Wow.
She's all over Facebook.
Wow. How old is your mom?
My mom, she's 70 now.
And that was back when computers were as big as a house.
Big, yes. They were as big as a small refrigerator. I'd come into the kitchen and she'd be like, oh, I'm here with the computer. You know, I'd be like looking for a snack or something and the thing would be this big, hooked up to the telephone.
Amazing.
Yeah.
I'm going to ask you another thing that I off notes, which I don't like doing, but I'm just so intrigued by this. Your now husband proposed to you in May 1983, and you accepted on Christmas Day 2005.
How did you know it was May? Did I say it was May? May of... but yes, you're right, yes.
So that's a phenomenal gap. At the time, did you just give him a flat-out no, or did you tell him to think about it?
No, I didn't give him a flat-out no. I said I wanted to think about it. And then I did think about it.
And then you married someone else.
Yes, I did. I married someone else.
And then you finally made your mind up.
After 15 years or something. I mean, you know, I married someone else not right after.
No.
It was 12 or something years after that. So anyway, yes, to answer your last question, yes, yeah. then.
So how did he manage to grind you down after all that time?
He didn't have to grind me down. You know, life has a certain way of presenting you. Life has a way of doing that itself sometimes. So it was something I had thought about in the meantime. And so by the time he asked again, I had thought about it, and I knew what I would say.
So he did ask again. You didn't just tell him
out
of the blue.
Yes, he did. Yes, he did ask again. In fact, he said, if I were to ask you again, do you know what you would say this time? And I had thought about it, and I said, yes, I do know what I would say. And then he asked me, and then I said, yes.
As I'm watching and listening to you, though, it occurred to me that so many of the current and previous generation of singer-songwriters must have been influenced by you in some way. And that must be a nice thing to hear when people cite you as an influence in interviews.
It is nice, yeah, when people do that.
Have you ever taken on an apprentice or a protege?
Sort of, not really. I mean, most people who... I mean, there's a songwriter in New York named Dawn Landes, and she opened for me for a while. She's now married to Josh Ritter. But I wouldn't say that I took her as an apprentice, but I liked her songwriting, and she opened for me for a while. I think most people who really have something they want to say, they go out and find a way to say it. You can't really apprentice someone.
Oh, I had an idea for a show. It was like you as the Donald Trump character.
Oh, I see. Ooh, that has potential. I'll think about that.
You do that. Tell us about your guitarist.
Oh, this is Jerry Leonard on guitar.
Let's say it for Jerry. The beautiful creations in sound are all coming from Jerry's fingers and feet over there. How long have you known Jerry for?
10 years.
Do you still like him after all this time?
I do, actually.
When did you first meet?
He was brought in by Rupert Hine to work on the album called Songs in Red and Grey. Yeah.
Cool. And here you are 10 years later.
Yeah.
Still happy.
Yeah.
It's a beautiful thing.
Yeah. Well, he used to play with David Bowie, so I had to give him up for a while.
Yeah. And People and Places is the volume that's currently out. We've got two more to come of the close-up series. When do you see that happening?
Volume 3 should be out in the spring of 2011, and then Volume 4 and the box set will be coming out in the fall of 2011. So there we are.
Lovely. That's your next year,
yes,
all mapped out.
Yes, exactly.
Well, thank you so much for playing for us. For now, let's hear it for Suzanne Vega.
Thank you.